All of our kids have come to Woody High. It's a great school. You get a great education here. And it's one of the reasons that I had a chance to talk to Mr. McGuire, Mr. Coleman, and others, and Superintendent Johnson about trying to help with some really significant speakers here, because you are, this is a truly great high school in this region and state. And so I'm very happy that today Dr. Cyril Wecht is able to join us, and Mr. McGuire is going to introduce him, but let me just say that he is truly one of the great forensic scientists and lawyers in the world. He is truly known around the entire world for handling some of the most sensitive and difficult cases in modern history, including early on the assassination of President John F. Kennedy and looking into that matter, but more recently, some of the biggest headline cases that we have seen in terms of having to get physical evidence to determine the possible perpetrators of crimes and other very important issues. So I just want to say I'm just here to, like you, to watch and enjoy the afternoon, but I'm really happy that you're doing this. It's a great symbol of the great work that Woodland Hills does, and I'm very proud to be a member of this school district. So, Mr. McGuire.
Thanks for coming, everybody, and we owe it to Dean Gormley for bringing Dr. Wecht here, so we're grateful for him and his support of our programming here. Thank you for coming, and I think you're really in for a treat today with Dr. Wecht. So I think without further ado, I'm just going to welcome him to the podium.
Thank you, Mr. McGuire, Superintendent Johnson, members of the administration and faculty, and of course, most importantly, all of you students. I appreciate the gracious introduction by Dean Gormley, and you students who are much younger and more up to date, you'll forgive him. He's not aware of what's happening. They're talking about my worldwide reputation. He doesn't understand that it's intergalactically flying planets and so on. I won't feel offended. He's just a little behind the times, that's all. Well, I understand you folks are from different classes, presumably classes that have some academic interest as well as your own intellectual curiosity about some of the matters that fall within the realm of forensic science and legal medicine. Let me start by telling you something that is interesting and relevant. The idea that forensic science sprung from the loins of a television, modern-day fiction, and maybe a few cases like O.J. Simpson and JonBenet Ramsey, and we didn't know anything about any of this until there was Kluckman playing Quincy and so on. This is very, very erroneous. What I love to say when I'm talking especially to medical audiences, because there's a kind of a devilish pride in doing so, and that is to say to them that forensic science, forensic pathology, as we think of it today, is, and I say arguably, but it really is without argument, the oldest medical specialty in the entire field of medicine. So now they do heart surgery and lung surgery, you can get a new pancreas and you can get a new lung and so on. And the surgeons are doing incredible things, even operating on fetuses within their mother's uterus when they learn about certain defects. Think, you've been through these classes and history and so on. There once was an Athens and a Rome and an Israel and a China and a Persia and all the other great civilizations and Egypt and so on. What do you think those people who were very civilized, a hell of a lot more civilized than it appears our world is today, a lot more civilized, you think of the savagery and barbarity that's going on today, how do you think they dealt with sudden, unexpected, violent, suspicious, medically unattended deaths? Do you think they just said, well, guy, so he's floating in the water. Who cares? And my next door neighbor is found with his head bashed in and blood all over the place. What difference does it make to me? Don't you think there was some sensitivity, some curiosity, some concern? Sometimes it was based maybe on religious and other superstitious beliefs. But for whatever reason, there was a need. There was a visceral, emotional, intellectual, community, societal need to find out what happened. Tomorrow, it might be me floating in the water. It might be me with my head bashed in. So they would look into it. Now, they had limited knowledge of the human body and all of the things that are available to us in the field of forensic science, but whatever was available, they would have utilized to investigate those cases and to learn what went on. And they also had structured legal systems. Much of what we have today in law emanates from some of those marvelous legal principles that were implemented and adopted centuries, millennia ago. So you have, you see, in place already thousands of years ago, this kind of forensic scientific approach, the need to find out what happened in these cases of seemingly unnatural death. And then we move through the centuries very, very hurriedly, and you'll see references in religious tractates. You'll find them in the references of all the great religions, one way or another, in the Code of Hammurabi, and in the Carolinian Code, the Justinian Code, and so on. Then moving rapidly ahead, we see the Chinese wrote a very, very thick book translated into English, the Righting of Wrongs, in laying out the kinds of things that forensic scientific investigators, homicide detectives, should be aware of when they went to the scene and found the kind of situation that I have referred to. Then you see next of major importance and modern day relevance, the establishment of the coroner system. The kings of England, they weren't as strong. There wasn't an organized Great Britain as it is today, and as it has in more recent centuries. In those days, the king was as strong as he wished to be, as militant as his own personality perhaps directed him. But one thing that was important, when there were catastrophes of different kinds, could be a ship going aground on shoals with treasure trove. It could be a grand carriage with six magnificent steeds running over somebody. And the question was, what happens then to all of this valuable property? What happened when two feudal lords would battle and one would take over the lands and the thousands of serfs, the peasants, in essence, quasi-slaves? To whom did they belong? And the king said, hey, man, I want to get my piece of the action. I'm not going to leave it to these local lords and dukes and self-appointed local leaders and so on. I'm going to appoint people who are loyal to me, said the king, and who will go there. And in fairness to the king, they also had justice in mind, who will convene local folks of good standing, and let them evaluate the situation. Let them decide what should happen. Was somebody to blame? Did somebody commit a foul play act or so on? And these people appointed by the crown. What's the Latin word for crown? Corona. Corona coroner. Hence the beginning of the coroner system in about 12th century England. That was the system then that was brought to America, to the United States, to the colonies, back in the 17th into the 18th centuries. And that is a system that still exists today in about half of the jurisdictions, roughly. 1877, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts adopted the first medical examiner system, the first appointed system, ostensibly to make it more professional, to make it more reliable, less politically oriented and manipulated because of scandals that occurred there in the Boston area. Next, we changed 1917 in New York City, and then changes subsequently in large metropolitan areas and in some of the states on a statewide basis. And so today, roughly throughout the country, you've got a mixed bag. I'm not here to talk about the merits of the two systems, but I do want to make a point, having referred to these two systems. The idea that an elected coroner system is bad because it's elected and these people are not board certified forensic pathologists, and that an appointed medical examiner system is automatically good because these are board certified forensic pathologists is not a valid thought. It doesn't play out. When I first wrote my one of my books for public consumption, I think there are eight of them out there, never occurred to me at all. It was not a thought that ever entered my mind that I would be looking into those two systems and comparing and contrasting. I was involved in that on a political side for totally other reasons. As I began later and to this time, reflect upon the cases in which I have been involved, the cases about which I have written in my various books, The Cause of Death, Grave Seekers, Tales from the Morgue, Mortal Air, and so on and so forth. You know, most of these cases, and we're going to talk about a few of them very quickly, the problems, the conflicts, the screw-ups, the cover-ups, the manipulations have, ironically, occurred in medical examiner jurisdictions rather than in elected coroner's offices. So I just want to point that out to you because you're going to be the adults and you won't be voting on this in Allegheny County. That change was made back in 2006, and I'm not here to argue for or against, but just to make a point that I think is very important. What is necessary in that office, as it is in any kind of an office, does the person in charge know what he or she is doing? Are they aware of the responsibilities, of the important ramifications of that office's actions and decisions, etc.? How do you deal with an office of 50 or 100 employees? How do you hire and fire, etc., etc.? Just think about it. Because you see, when you go to medical school for 4 years and a year of internship and then 5, 6, 7, 8 years of residency in your specialty, and then you come out, fine. You're a very well-honed, highly sharpened person. Like one of my sons is a neurosurgeon. 8 years after 4 years at Harvard and 4 years at Penn Medical School and then 8 years in neurosurgery. Okay. Where in all of that time did he ever learn about running an office? Where in all of those years did he ever learn anything about hiring and firing, about dealing with people, and so on? Something to think about. That's the subject for another day, dealing with people. We need a little bit more of that for doctors and their training on how to deal with people. In addition to learning how to do brain or heart surgery. Nothing pleases me more than when I hear back about the two of my kids in medicine, neurosurgeon, my daughter and OB-GYN, to hear about how nice they were. That pleases me much more than your son saved my daughter's life, etc. That's great. But what's even more wonderful to me as a parent is to hear back from them that I really like the way your son or your daughter treats me, and so on. That's what's important in medicine. I want to toss that out to you because I'm sure amongst a group of bright students like you folks, many of you will be going into pre-med. So let's talk about some of the cases in which I have been involved. And I'm going to leave some time then for questions. And there's no hurry. I've already made arrangements. I've talked to Superintendent Johnson. He's going to take a 10-minute break for all of you later on this afternoon to call your homes and tell your parents that you're staying here for dinner. Superintendent Johnson is bringing in some very nice snacks, okay. And we'll have a discussion You'll be home for the weekend parties. Okay, so John F. Kennedy, the first case in which I became involved that, for whatever good, and it has been good, it has been pleasant and exciting, sometimes difficult, many times controversial, but certainly intellectually stimulating. John F. Kennedy. My involvement started when I was invited to present a paper at the American Academy of Forensic Sciences. The AAFS is the largest and most prestigious group of forensic scientists in the world, and they have an annual meeting every year. It's always in late February. The program chair, or the co-program chair, going into the 65 meeting, happened to be the director of the then called, so-called crime lab. I prefer the appellation of forensic science lab, but called crime lab. And Charlie McInerney, wonderful guy. And I was an assistant district attorney, and would spend most of my time there in the crime lab. And Charlie said to me one day, hey, we're gonna be doing in the plenary session, the academy is comprised of different sections, pathology, toxicology, psychiatry, criminalistics, jurisprudence, anthropology, odontology, entomology, linguistics, nursing, and so on. And they meet, and each section has its own meetings, but then they always have a day in which they choose an overarching subject, which is designed to hold the interest and be of relevance to as many of the groups as possible from a broad forensic scientific standpoint. So Charlie said to me, we're going to do the Warren Commission report for the plenary session of the Academy in February 65. The Warren Commission report had been issued late September into October of 64, the assassination of the president having occurred on Friday, November 22nd, 1963. So Charlie said to me, would you like to represent the pathology section? I was a relatively young guy, a fairly new member in the Academy, and I said, Charlie, be happy to. I went to the Carnegie Library, our great library, and they already had the 26 volumes. They were already there. I don't remember exactly when in the fall, but they got them pretty darn fast when they were issued. And by the way, just so you'll know the way in which the government has handled this case from the very beginning, they put out 26 volumes with no index. Would you like me to assign you a topic relative to one particular aspect of a multifaceted, highly complex, very controversial matter and tell you to go, there's 26 volumes, you'll find it in there. No index. So unless you think, well, this was a monumental task, let me tell you, one woman with whom I established a very close relationship, a wonderful woman, Sylvia Maher, M-E-A-G-H-E-R, pronounced Maher, who lived alone, a single woman in Greenwich Village, working at the United Nations. Sylvia, pre-computer, back then, in the late 60s, into the early 70s, no computers. Sylvia put together an index that is still used today. So one person did this on her own, but the United States government cannot. It was never their intention, never their desire, never their hope to have people become interested and delve into the JFK assassination. Quite the opposite was true. So anyway, I found finally what I was looking for, the autopsy, et cetera, and I gave my talk February 65, and since then, till the present day, things have moved. I don't think there's anybody else who has testified, certainly outside the people who were directly involved, the pathologist, any others in the actual handling of the body, who has testified now three times. I testified, well, let me go back a little bit. So I go in, I gave my talk, and then all kinds of things happen. There is a related case, for those of you who have followed the assassination of JFK, know a little bit about it. There came to be a case involving a prominent businessman in New Orleans by the name of Clay Shaw. The district attorney in New Orleans, Nolens is pronounced, Nolens one word, Jim Garrison filed charges against Clay Shaw, essentially incriminating him peripherally in the assassination, not as a shooter, but in the plot. And District Attorney Garrison consulted me, and I worked with him on the case, and so on. And I told Garrison that I would need to see the autopsy material, and so on, as I would in any other case in which I function as a forensic pathology medical legal consultant. And the government said they would not do that. There was an agreement that had been made, I don't have time to digress, a unique thing, truly, in the dictionary definition of the word unique, never before and never since, in which it was determined that Jacqueline Kennedy, the president's wife, was the owner of everything related to the assassination. The clothing, the x-rays, the photographs, the bullet, the rifle, the fragments, even John Connolly's clothing, the governor of Texas, who was wounded, sitting in that limousine with Kennedy the day in which they were shot in Dallas. And the agreement said nobody could see those for 75 years, with the exception after 5 years, a, quote, recognized expert in the field of forensic pathology with a serious historical purpose, unquote, could apply after 5 years. And that's a long, long story. Eventually, but sticking with this matter chronologically, Garrison then filed a motion in federal court in D.C. To get the government to give me these things to review for his upcoming trial of Clay Shaw. I testified under oath about what is involved in forensic pathology, et cetera, and so on. And the judge ruled from the bench that day that the government should make those materials available to me. And the government attorneys, and I'll never forget, a fairly young guy and graduate of law school, some knowledge of courts and procedures and protocol and so on. I thought, my God, these government attorneys vehemently and with total lack of respect, federal judge said, we'll appeal their words till hell freezes over. And as a result, because Garrison had to go to trial, I then did not testify, my choice. And I'm proud of myself, a young man, eager to get involved in a matter like that. I'm proud of the decision that I made to have the sense of professional ethics and not to testify, not having seen the autopsy materials, and not to testify just based upon what I thought was the case. Then, after 5 years of that agreement, which I referred to a moment ago, that absurd agreement which Jacqueline Kennedy really had nothing to do with, but it was drafted to keep all of these things a secret. I then finally got in, and that's a long story too, but I finally got in as the first non-government forensic pathologist to examine all the autopsy materials in 1972. And that is when I pointed out, among other things, that the president's brain was missing. And this is very, very important. You get into the question of how many shooters, from what direction, and so on. When you have a brain that has been injured like this, and you want to determine trajectory, in other cases, for other reasons, but let's stick to this kind of a situation, you don't examine the brain fresh. The brain is as much a dense liquid as it is a hard solid. And especially when it's been traumatized, if you attempted to cut it, it would just, you know, like fall apart. So what you do is you fix it in formalin. That's the fixative solution that we use in pathology. You fix the tissue. You fix the brain for 2 to 3 weeks, and then it hardens. And not to be insensitive or the least bit glib, but just so you'll understand, the consistency then changes from a well-done soft-boiled egg to a hard-boiled egg, which you can then slice, serially section. And you take the brain then after 2-3 weeks, and then you make sections, and you lay them out. And you can follow the trajectory. You can see the hemorrhagic tract of the bullet or bullets. That was never done. The brain was fixed. And they did go back on December 7th. And it's a supplement to their report in the Warren Commission report. And the quote is, serial sections of the brain are not made in order to preserve the specimen, quote unquote. Preserve the specimen for whom? Jackie Kennedy to put on her mantelpiece for the son and daughter of the president to have this for future reference? For whom was it going to be preserved? Well, it was preserved. And there are references, I don't have time to get into all of that, that show that it was around. And then somewhere between 65 to 66, the time in which that agreement, that gift from Jackie Kennedy was accepted formally, legally by the government and put in place, and then the inventory was done. In that period from April 65 to October 66, the brain winds up missing. Oh, I wasn't the first one to discover it. Quite a few people well knew about it. It was there. Nobody had ever said a word. And there was page one of the New York Times, August 27, 1972. Fred Graham, the reporter, had an exclusive with me. He had helped me get in after I was being stonewalled in my request to get in to examine these materials. So I had an exclusive with Fred Graham. And page one, President's brain missing. And to this day, it remains missing. To this day, unaccounted for. All right, so let me just tell you, I don't want to talk only about JFK, but just so you'll understand, and you're young, your parents, many of them will remember somewhat, but now we go back 52 years plus, so they were only kids. Some of them weren't even born either. Your grandparents will remember. Every poll that has been taken, and the first national poll was 77, 78. CBS, Dan Rather, I was interviewed many times. Every poll that has been taken reflects that a clear majority of the American public does not accept the Warren Commission report. As high as 80% and as low as 65%. And this is despite the intensive efforts of the federal government in many ways, some extremely rotten, vicious, illegal, vituperative, vehement, you pick your word. I mean, just dastardly what they have done. Despite all of these efforts, as well as the companionship they have enjoyed from the major news media, which accepted very quickly back then. You see, you got to understand, you don't know this. Today, you are aware, those of you who follow politics a little bit, you know everything about politics. You even know that Donald Trump was attacked by the bald eagle in his office last night, right? If you really Google, you'll find out every single thing now about Cruz and Rubio and so on, local politicians, etc. I mean, a lot of things. If you're going to think about running for political office, you better keep that in mind. Now, don't pinch a cheerleader's rear end, and don't smoke a joint, because someday you're going to be asked, did you ever do that? You'll be asked. It'll be there. I remember, I think Obama had to announce back when he was running that, yeah, he had smoked marijuana once or so on. I mean, it wasn't that way then. You've got to understand. Ask grandma, ask grandpa if they had some political awareness and so on. Whatever the government put out, that was it. Nobody questioned the government. This was pre-Watergate, pre-Vietnam. If the government told you something, that was it. We're still learning things today about some of the actions that occurred in World War II, as well as in the Korean War, 50-54, as well as the Vietnam War. We're still learning things today. And by the way, I mentioned that too. People say, oh, come on, man. How could there still be a secret cover-up on JFK and so on? Well, if you can cover up things from those events, not that they were unimportant, insignificant, but by comparison to the assassination of a president in broad daylight in a major city, how does it compare to the importance of what some of our soldiers did in a village in Vietnam, what some of our soldiers did or found or saw in one of those other wars? You're dealing with these people. You and I too, and I'm much older and have been around and so on. I think I understand, but I would not be able to function like these super spies, these CIA type. I mean, it's a whole other world for them. When they see the Star-Spangled Banner flying, when they hear the song sung, when they see the flag flying, they hear and see something that you and I, we're just regular citizens. We're just regular, you know, average day patriots. We don't really understand what is necessary and what is good for America. They do. You got to keep that in mind. And so when it comes to covering up and keeping things totally clandestine after decades and decades, and the idea that, gee, that could never happen. But let's go back and see. I want you to know that even though that two-thirds to three-quarters of the American public rejects the Warren Commission, and they're not really sure, they don't know the case, they haven't studied it, they don't know about the single bullet theory, and maybe I'll briefly refer to that in a moment, but they just know viscerally. It's something like the old, was it Barnum and Bailey? Was it Barnum? P.T. Barnum, I guess, said, you can fool some of the people some of the time, but not all of the people all of the time, or whoever the hell said that, but somebody said it like that. It's just something that the American public just did not accept. And then when you get into the case, so to begin with, know that the two pathologists who were in charge of the autopsy done at Bethesda Naval Hospital, just outside D.C., the body having been illegally taken out of Dallas, there was no law in Dallas or the state of Texas that permitted them to remove anybody, including the President of the United States. That was a local medical examiner case, and the medical examiner, who was a colleague of mine, was there. They pushed him aside, put him up against the wall. They even threatened him physically. Hands were on guns, the FBI and the Secret Service. They took the body of the president. Okay, that was an illegal act, but in and of itself, actually, should have worked to their benefit because it now gave them that additional time of about 8 hours to get everything in place. Call in the most prominent forensic pathologist. Hey, this is a very tough case. Multiple gunshot wounds. You got to determine angle, sequence, trajectory. You got to correlate those wounds with the wounds of Governor John Connally, the governor of Texas, who was seated directly in front of the president. Their wives seated respectively to their left in this open limousine. Two Secret Service men in the front, Greer and Kellerman. A very, very difficult case. I wouldn't like to have that case, I'll tell you, at all. And the prominent people, one of whom was my chief where I trained, and so they were available, they were ready within an hour drive or flying time from Washington, D.C. Not one of them was called, not one of them. And these are the people who lectured to the military. When I was in the Air Force for 2 years, I attended some of these lectures. My chief was such a nice guy, and he knew of my plans to go into forensic pathology, and he told me about these lectures at the Armed Forces Institute of Pathology in Washington, D.C., which at that time was the mecca of pathology, and he sent me up there twice for those programs, and I met these people. They shared a flaw, an absolutely irreversible flaw in common. They were civilians. You're not going to get a doctor who has achieved the highest level in his, her profession, whatever it may be, after 30, 35, 40 years, and proceed to tell them what to do, and maybe do some things which would be so improper, so unethical, seemingly so incompetent, so negligent, as to ruin a reputation, a career of 3, 4, 5 decades. But military people, yes, they'll take orders. And there were 4-star admirals and generals in the autopsy room that night, as we came to learn. The two guys who did the autopsy, Humes and Boswell by name, Humes and Boswell, listen to this carefully. You get the background? This is the President of the United States. This is not you or me or your neighbor or somebody nobody really cares much about except your immediate family. All right? This is the President of the United States. You got the governor of the great state of Texas wounded. Got all these questions to be answered. And we call in the two naval pathologists, career military people, Humes and Boswell, who have never done a single gunshot wound autopsy in their entire careers. You like that? Let me give you a retrospective analogy. Let's say the president that day had slipped in the bathroom, hurriedly getting out of the shower, had fallen backward, struck his head, and was, quote, seeing stars, a concussion. And he was dazed. So I'll ask you, what specialist would you call in? I won't take the time. Neurologist, neurosurgeon, internist, want to check out the heart and lungs. You know something about medicine, ophthalmologist, because sometimes the eye grounds will tell you something about what's going on intracranially and so on. Whatever, okay. What if, under my hypothetical, they would have called in an obstetrician, a dermatologist, and a plastic surgeon? What do you think about that, huh? Okay. This, you got to understand this, because there's no doubt in my mind, you come from families, and you are, in your families, you've inherited, it's not genetic, but you've inherited when you have your discussion, as you will when you go home, I hope to talk about this, and they're going to be that 25%, 30%, whatever, whose families are going to tell you, ah, Ed Wecht, that's a bunch of BS, he's been saying this for all these years, and so on and so forth, the Warren Commission is from the government, and so on. So just say, Grandpa, do you know anything about the people that did the autopsy? Grandma, do you know anything about that? And then I'll show you how incompetent they were. They missed a bullet hole in the front of the president's neck. I want you to take a look at the person sitting next to you. Young lady, young man, whatever. Do you think you would have to go 4 years of medical school and 5-6 years of pathology to see a hole in their neck? What do you think? Huh? I think Superintendent Johnson would throw your rear end out of school at that damn fast if you couldn't spot that, right? How did they miss it all? As far as they were concerned, they were seeing what is referred to medically as a tracheostomy, an incision into the windpipe. When the brain has been damaged, whether it's from a stroke or from a bullet, it doesn't function. You've got to take over the brain's activities. Sorry to disappoint the romantics amongst you who are looking forward to Valentine's Day and all of those heart-colored and heart-designed flowers and cards and so on. The heart is nothing but a muscular pump. That's all it is. Ladies, start ruining your day. That's all it is. And it does what the brain tells it to do. And if the brain isn't functioning, the heart isn't going to function. And the lungs aren't going to function. So you're going to take over those activities. And one of the things you do is you do a tracheostomy. So you suction out blood and mucus, you take out carbon dioxide, you put in oxygen, and you try to keep that body alive while you deal with the injuries and so on. So they never knew until the next day when the body was gone and the report had been submitted to President Johnson and J. Edgar Hoover, the FBI. The next day, they did not know until then that there was a bullet hole in the neck that they missed. Well, don't have time to go into that, because I do want to just touch on some of the other cases. This is what led to the promulgation of the most absurd forensic scientific fallacy ever promulgated that would be laughed out of a courtroom in East Podunksville, let alone even a larger city with sharper attorneys, would even make its way into the court. The single bullet theory. The single bullet theory. This I gotta show you. Come here. Here, gentlemen. Here, you two guys. Bring your shirt. Very quick. This I gotta show you. You know, what did you say? Turn it that way. Get behind him. No, that way, yeah. Okay? All right. Okay. 30 inches between the president's chest and the governor's back. Okay, here's the single bullet theory, okay, for especially those of you whose grandmas and grandpas are going to tell you that Wecht is a BS artist, okay? Okay, so the bullet, there's Oswald. This is the single bullet theory, and this is the Warren Commission report. Lee Harvey Oswald, sole assassin. He's up there on the 6th floor, Texas School Book Depository building, okay? So just picture him there. So you got the bullet moving from up downward, from right to left, and from back to front.
The boulder comes in, hits Kennedy about 5.5 inches below the level of the shoulder. To begin with, the exit wound here is 11.5 degrees higher. That's the beginning. How do my colleagues deal with that? Oh, they say, what if the president were bent over? You know, he forgot to tie his shoelace, he was scratching his groin, you know, whatever. Yeah, presidents, you do that. You know, an open parade, what the hell you want to show? You want, you know, your common folks, okay? So that's the way they deal with that. Except on the Zapruder film, which is the most important piece of photographic evidence in this case, there the president is not bent over. The president is waving. Come on, wave. Now the bullet comes out, okay? So it's moving to the front, downward and leftward. It doesn't catch Conley. Left shoulder area, maybe graze him and so on. Where does the bullet hit Conley? Behind the right armpit. Called right posterior axillary. Axilla is a synonym for armpit. So the bullet coming out here, moving down, in midair, turns, goes over here, slams him behind his right armpit, goes down through the chest, pierces the lung, exits after destroying 4 inches, Governor, wait, there's your friends out there. So, exits below the level of the nipple. The governor's got this big white Stetson hat, and he's about, right about here. You can see it's on the scooter. Believe me, I'm not giving you something that is subjective. The big white Stetson hat here at this level, right here. The bullet coming out downward, hooks back around, slams into the back of his right wrist, breaks the distal end of the radius, one of two bones. How tall are you?
6'3".
Yeah, you're almost like Governor Conley. You got around 50 like that. 6'4", big bone Texan. He produces a comminuted fracture, which means a fragmented fracture of the radius. And the radius broadens down here. Broadens before it meets the small 8 bones of the wrist. And then comes up, goes into his left thigh. On the day of the shooting, during the autopsy, when they had the bullet hole in the president's back and knew nothing about the bullet hole here, where the hell is the bullet? Just like a movie, a book that has to end. They get a call from the FBI, that a maintenance man back at Parkland Hospital in Dallas, late that afternoon, trying to get the corridors open to get to the men's room, finding a block by stretchers, had found a bullet beneath the stretcher that nobody else had seen. The pathologist that night at Bethesda, doing the autopsy, they said that the bullet that went into the president's back when they applied pressure at the Parkland Hospital ER on his chest for cardiac massage, that pressure applied in the front forced a bullet back out through the same channel. It was like you driving through the Fort Pitt tunnels and you decide you're going in the wrong direction, you just put the car in reverse and back out. That's not what happens. Bullets become encased by tissue, by hemorrhage. They don't move around, okay, through tissues. But that's what they concluded. Okay. The next morning, when they learned about the hole here, they said, the bullet did go through, saw the starched collar of the president, got frightened to death, and plopped into the front of his clothing. 5 months later, when they had to make that bullet, the stretcher bullet, Commission Exhibit 399, the hero of the Warren Commission report, the bullet responsible for 7 wounds, in Kennedy, out Kennedy, in Conley, out Conley, in Conley, out Conley, into Conley, 7 wounds, that bullet, the hero of the single bullet theory, that bullet now is from Conley's left thigh. You with me? I know it's Friday afternoon, you've had a hell of a week. So the night of the autopsy, the bullet is from his back. The next morning, it's from his neck. 5 months later, it's from Conley's left thigh. You like that? Thank you, Governor. Thank you, President.
Please understand, the single bullet theory is not just a piece of evidence, it is a sine qua non. And even for those of you who haven't taken Latin, You know what that means. Something without which something else cannot exist. It is the essence. So before you get into it, we don't have time. That's all the politics and the machinations of just incredible. But just know that before you get into any of that, who was Oswald? What did he do in Russia for 2 years? How come the FBI didn't question him when he married the niece of a KGB colonel? The KGB was the most powerful secret organization in the world, making our CIA and FBI and other groups combined look like child's play. And he's married now to the niece of a KGB colonel, but they never found it necessary to question her. I mean, on and on and on. Before you get to any of that, the whole Cuban and anti-Cuban and mafia business, before you get any of that, you got to first deal with the single bullet theory. Because if you don't have the single bullet theory, you've got two people shooting. And just so you'll know, that's what happened. You got two people shooting, one from the rear and one from behind the picket fence on the grassy knoll. You'll get into that. I hope some of you are interested. But you keep it in mind. I didn't want to just leave this hanging. So you know, two shooters. I personally don't believe that Oswald was a shooter, but I don't have that evidentiary burden. You want Oswald as a shooter? Fine, take him as a shooter. But you must understand, when two or more people are involved in a criminal act, you have, by definition, in every jurisdiction under federal law, a conspiracy. Two of you don't both have to rape the girl, but one of you was there, or one of you brought her there, or one of you sat in the car while she was being raped by you. Well, whatever. Two of you planned the bank robbery, or whatever. You've got a conspiracy. That is the problem that confronts the government. They can't open it up, you see. You're pregnant, you're not pregnant. You can't have, No, I want you to understand. You've got the single bullet theory, and then you can argue it still is defeated for many, many other reasons, but just sticking with that from a hard forensic scientific standpoint. All right, just a few minutes. You're not old enough. Oh, your teachers, well, they're not old enough either, but maybe Robert Kennedy. I wish I was a formal consultant. My good friend Tom Noguchi, in the coroner to the stars, and we're still close personal friends now, with the LA medical examiner coroner. When you go home, ask your parents, your grandparents, how far, I'm going to ask the adults in the audience, if any of you think you know too, I just don't think that you would be. But Robert Kennedy, by the way, very, very, very quickly. It is now June 1968. Bobby Kennedy, who had been Attorney General, then left the office, then was elected to the U.S. Senate from New York as a carpetbagger, even though that wasn't his state, nor was it for Hillary Clinton either. But in any event, he's now running for president. And he has just won the Democratic primary in California. That's it. He's now got the nomination locked in. It's the Ambassador Hotel in LA. They know they can't let him go out into that crowd. He'll never get out of there. He'll be there for hours and hours. Come on, Senator, we're going out the back way through the kitchen. They're going out through the back way. Rosie Greer, this wonderful African-American athlete, and they're moving on, and there's Sirhan, a Palestinian immigrant, and he shoots Kennedy. We know that. There's no question. We know that. Sirhan shoots as Kennedy is walking toward him. Okay? If anybody thinks they know, what was the distance within a range of the muzzle of Sirhan's gun from Robert Kennedy when that shooting occurred? We'll start with Dean Gormley. He's still a young man, but he's
8 feet.
Ken, you're right in the ballpark. Anybody else? 5 feet. 5 feet, 3 feet, 8 feet, 10 feet. Ready for this? Documented again. I'll tell you if I'm giving you my opinion, differentiated from that which exists with unequivocal, corroborated fact. The distance of Sirhan's muzzle from Bobby Kennedy, the fatal shot, 1 to 1.5 inches. With the bullet moving slightly forward. Never brought up in the trial of Sirhan Sirhan. The defense never brought in an expert, and the prosecution, of course, stayed away from it. That's the Bobby Kennedy case. Mary Jo Kopechne, one of the secretaries in the congressional office of Senator Ted Kennedy, just to round out the Kennedy trio. She's found, at that time, unidentified body in a small body of water, Poca Pond, in Chappaquiddick. Okay, so I've just, young lady, you're the coroner. No, you're the medical examiner of Massachusetts. You're in a state that adopted the first medical examiner system in 1877. You guys are way ahead of the game. It's now 92 years later, it's 1969. We have a young woman, and she's floating in the water. Madam medical examiner, what would you do? Tell me. Well, oh, come on, what would you decide? What do you think has to be done? Do you want to have the body examined? You want to identify her? You want to determine the cause of death? You want to do those things? Okay. Well, do they require an autopsy? No autopsy was done. Mary Jo Kopechne, a young woman floating in water, no autopsy was done. And then we move very, very quickly through a whole bunch of cases, and I'm sorry, we don't have time. Elvis Presley, talking about medical examiner, they finessed the case and said it was private, but then they still go over there, and the medical examiner announces that Presley died from heart disease. Not only heart disease, he had 12 central nervous system depressant drugs. Tammy Wynette, and then Sonny Bombulo and Gene Harris, and Branch Davidian, Shootout Fire, and Chandra Levy, and Ron Brown, and Vincent Foster, and then O.J. Simpson, and JonBenet Ramsey, and Anna Nicole Smith and her son, and Michael Jackson, and on and on and on. Let me just tell you that these cases where there have arisen and remain today conflicts as to the cause of death, the time of death, the manner of death. Marilyn Monroe is another good example. I'm still dealing with that case. People are so interested, and as they have been in the past, in writing books and so on. The bottom line is that forensic science, by definition, is a science. Pathology is a very important specialty. And it's not that pathologists are smarter than other doctors, but we have an opportunity to do things that other doctors don't. I'm always reminded of a wonderful axiom which you'll appreciate maybe later on, especially for those of you who move into medicine. The internist is a doctor who knows everything and does nothing. The surgeon is a doctor who knows nothing and does everything. The psychiatrist is a doctor who knows nothing and does nothing. The pathologist is a doctor who knows everything a day too late. But that's it. But we have that opportunity. And where you have these screw-ups, where you have these cases that remain today as major areas of controversy, and importance matters, very important, for a variety of reasons. Obviously, John F. Kennedy as president of the country at the top of that list, no matter whether Republican, Democrat, liberal, conservative, black, white, young, old, male, female, doesn't make any difference. This is the president of our country, shot down in broad daylight in a major city, and we're still 53 years later arguing, I didn't get into all of this, where was the bullet wound on the head? Where was it located? The pathologist who did the autopsy located it at the base of the skull. Four pathologists brought in by the government. Brought in by the government, not critic researchers like me. Brought in by the government in 1968, moved the bullet hole up 4 inches, 100 millimeters. Again, do you think if I gave you a black crayon and I said a red crayon, whatever, I want you to mark something in the back of your classmate's head, and do you think if I gave you a diagram to copy from, would you be 4 inches, you know, take the largest head among you? I mean, 4 inches goes from bottom to top. How in the world can you be off 4 inches? This is from the government's own people still arguing today. I just want you to understand that. And then all of these other cases, and many of them are fascinating. Many of them have fascinating aspects of drug abuse, sex, involvement with famous people like Marilyn Monroe, with both Senator and President Kennedy. Very, very interesting. Well, okay, I hope that this will give you a better idea of what is involved in forensic pathology, although these kinds of cases don't occur every day, thank God. But this is what we deal with. Known, alleged, suspected homicides, accidents, suicides. Violent, sudden, suspicious, unexpected, unexplained, medically unattended deaths to determine the cause of death and the manner of death. Manner of death, natural, accident, suicide, homicide, undetermined. Guy found dead, gunshot wound to the head. The bullet is there. The gun is there. The bullet, the casing for the bullet. Did he shoot himself accidentally while cleaning the gun? Did he shoot himself deliberately to commit suicide? Or did he shoot himself? I just had attorneys from West Virginia yesterday brought me a new case, a 4-year-old case of a young man dead with a gunshot wound in the back of the head, undetermined, and now they have ruled it a homicide. So I'll be reviewing this case to determine do they have a case for homicide. Testified last week in St. Joseph's, Missouri, city where Jesse James was assassinated. By the way, in St. Joseph's, Missouri, and the death of a young child, and homicide or accident. Was the child beaten, or did the child fall from 3-4 crates that she and her brother erected? These are the kinds of issues that you deal with. Very, very interesting. So I hope that many of you who are thinking of forensic science, keep in mind there are two wonderful programs right here in the city of Pittsburgh. We have a 5-year program at Duquesne University leading to a master's degree in forensic science, an excellent program that was established in 2001. Wonderful, wonderful program. And then we have a program at Carlo University, a separate program, a 4-year program leading to a BS, where people learn to do autopsies, work in forensic science. The end point not being to become an autopsy technician, but to learn and to go on, and we encourage them to go on to medicine, to other fields of forensic science, and so on. And then, of course, there are wonderful programs all around the country. I'm not suggesting only here in Pittsburgh, but I do want to mention that we have these two very fine programs right here in Pittsburgh. So I wish you all the very best, and good wishes to you and your families for the holidays. Thank you very much.